So I'm going to go over procedural programming, object-oriented programming, and functional programming, and sort of try and talk about the differences and some pros and cons to each of those, and then I'll wrap it up at the end. So, procedural. This works everywhere, on every platform. You've got some pretty strong pros there. It's already been written. It's relatively easy to read. You start at the top, you head down. So those are pluses. Some minuses. Might be a little bit more difficult to make changes, right? Keeping track of making sure things happen in the same order and that you don't sort of move this monolithic thing that starts at the top and goes downwards, it can get a little bit brittle. Sometimes it's difficult to understand side effects. If you take that code and you call it in a different context, is it going to behave the same way? If you call that code two times in a row, is it going to behave the same way? So there's some potential negatives to your sort of standard procedural code. So we've all seen procedural. So we've all been hearing about object-oriented now for a while. This works in traditional. It works in .NET. There's a couple of features in there that are .NET only. But in general, object-oriented programming works very well in both platforms. There are some pros. It's taught in a lot of universities. If you go hire someone new, they've probably heard the words object-oriented smushed up next to each other, and they understand the concept in general. It's very friendly to IntelliSense. You've got some kind of object, you press dot, it tells you all the things you can do with that object. That's definitely a plus. It's possible to multi-thread with object-oriented code. It's pretty difficult with procedural, but it starts to get a lot more doable in object-oriented. And your state changes are constrained. So you start putting data inside of that class. The only people that modify that data are functions inside of that class. If you want to know who changes this stuff, you don't have to look very far, right? It's a lot easier to manage that. There are still some cons. State is still a big con. So if I make a change in the middle of calling a routine, and the person that's calling that routine doesn't know that it's going to change the state of the object, that means they can't call this method with the same parameters twice and get the same result. They're going to get a different result the second time they call it. It's very non-intuitive. People don't tend to expect this function that returns a value and takes some parameters to behave differently when you call it on a Tuesday versus on a Wednesday. So that's not a nice thing to do to people that are new to your system. Some of the tools for composition are a little bit limited. You can imagine you've got some inheritance hierarchy, and you want to inherit. You're creating like an animals hierarchy, so you know that dogs bark. So you think, okay, I can make like a barkable object or something like that, and all of the animals that can bark will inherit from bark. Ta-da, I solved my problem. Well, what happens when you need to do more than just bark with your animal class? So say you have sea lion. Sea lions can bark and they can swim. Well, I can't inherit from both swimmable and barkable. So things start to get a little bit complicated when you try and overuse inheritance to solve problems with composition. So our third option here is functional. So functional has been around at least as long as procedural has been. It's not new. But in terms of synergy technologies, most of our features and functionality that support this are in synergy.net. So we have some nice pros. It's pretty easy to reason about what your code is going to do when it's called. So we're constraining the amount of state that we have. If you call this function twice with the same parameters, you will get the same result over and over and over and over and over again. If you want to get a different result, give it different parameters. Composability is really good in this environment, right? Now you can make guarantees about how well I can go chain from this function call to that function call, because they're not going to have any weird side effect, nasty interactions with each other. Functional programming is very multi-threaded friendly. So when you're not relying on state that one thread could try and access at the same time as some other thread, multi-threading gets a lot easier. There are definitely fewer bugs in functional code than in the other paradigms. And this really just comes back to things are easier to think about when they don't change out from under you. We do have some downsides. Code's much more explicit. If I need some data, I need to be explicitly handed that data. So call sites can get a little bit verbose. If you just need to add a little bit of state all the way at the top of your application, all the way down to the bottom of your application, that can be a lot of places where you need to add a new parameter. So it's not perfect. Sometimes you have to write a lot of code. It's not taught in most schools. So some people coming out of school will understand what you're talking about if you start talking to them about functional programming, but not all of them. It's nowhere near as ubiquitous as object-oriented programming is. It very much assumes that refactoring is fast and or easy. So that goes back to the adding parameters and removing parameters and changing state. And it's also a completely different way of thinking about the problems that you have at hand. So quick discussion on state. You don't have to go all the way to pure functional. Purity is potentially overrated here. You can get partway there. Minimizing the places that make changes improves your debuggability. Things don't surprise you and jump out of the woodworks. Whenever possible, methods should return the same value with the same inputs. So resist the urge to go increment something in global state somewhere and completely change the outcome of calling that method. Statefulness makes writing tests harder. If you've ever tried to write a unit test and you have a bunch of global state, I'm sure you've run into, how do I get this global state in the right state for this particular unit test? It gets really, really difficult to try and manage that. And unconstrained state changes are not a friend of multithreading. So if you ever find yourself needing to make your software run faster, unconstrained state changes are going to cause you some problems. And same thing with scalability.
So thank you, Jeff.